I'm good.
Please be seated now. Our service is about to begin. We ask that you silence your cell phones. Welcome to worship. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Congregation of the South Jersey Shore. We welcome guests and visitors, members and friends, everyone gathered here this morning and virtually live on Facebook. To those of us joining virtually, we welcome your comments as well as your joys and sorrows on that platform. Please remember that this is video that will be on the internet, so do not share information that should be kept private. Come into this place and let its silence heal your spirit. Come into this place of memory and let its history warm your soul. Come into this place of prophecy and power and let its vision change your heart. My name is Mike Anisian. I am your worship associate this morning. I am a member of this congregation, and I am currently on the road cleanup team, which, just to remind you, will next be doing so June 12th. Our worship service today is led by Dr. Marcia Fiedler, who tells me she much prefers to be referred to as Marcia. She has been the coordinator of Jewish studies at Stockton University for over 20 years, where she teaches courses in the Old Testament, women in the Bible, Bible and film, Jewish women, Bible as literature, Jewish storytelling, and Hebrew language to students of all faiths. Marcia, originally from Pittsburgh, grew up in a modern Orthodox Jewish home and attended an Orthodox Jewish day school where more time was spent on biblical studies and Jewish law than English studies. She also spent 5 months in Israel studying biblical sources at an Orthodox Jewish girls' yeshiva. Marcia shows her students that the Bible does not view women as negative in a negative manner, translations do. Today, Marcia will show you that you can't believe everything you read. What a shock. There are many words that have been mistranslated and that have been distorted from the real story. Then you can decide for yourself if Adam was pushed or if he jumped holding Eve's hand. Video of today's service will be available on our YouTube channel later today. If you care to tweet during the service, you can use the hashtag UUCSJS. Welcome to worship. Thank you. into this place of healing. Welcome into this place of challenge and growth. Welcome into this place of imperfection and aspiration. You are whole, you are holy, and you are wholly loved. Our chalice lighter today is Nancy Watson. Please read with me the chalice lighting words from the Order of Service. We kindle this flame, honoring the doorways in our souls, the windows through which we gaze in each other, the balconies where we catch glimpses of sky, the thresholds we stand on this morning, wondering, hoping, fearing, dreaming. Please rise in body or spirit and hum along to the gathering hymn, Rising in Green. Rising Green, that's number 1068. And I assume you can sing, although it doesn't say that in here. Thank you. joys and concerns. A book is provided in the foyer in which you are invited to write whatever joys and sorrows you have as you enter. I will now read what you have written. Sorrow. Marking 1 million lives lost due to COVID-19. Thanks to Nancy and Mike for an interesting and informative day of dragonflies and damselflies. For those of you who don't know, Nancy and I did a dragonfly program here yesterday. Let us share a quiet time together and reflect on our week. During the musical interlude, you may come forward and place a pebble in the water to acknowledge a personal joy or sorrow. Be in the spirit of prayer. Blessed and holy creation, universe of wonder, mystery beyond definition, we share today our joys and sorrows, placing stones that make ripples in the water or a gentle sound in the chalice. Our hearts are touched by this shared ritual, and we are connected. We hold in our hearts this morning the community of Buffalo, New York, the members of which are just amongst the latest of us to suffer from our country's original racist sin. We pray for the people of Ukraine, as well as the peoples of the world living under autocratic rule, or who may be so subjected to in the future. We pray for those who are apart from us, whether by distance, time, or conflict unresolved. We pray for those who thirst, whether for water, dignity, or justice. We pray for our small, blue, fragile planet. We offer all of these and those joys and sorrows that remain unspoken in our hearts into the care of the universe, May our joys be multiplied and our sorrows diminished by this sharing. Amen.
Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
And thank you so much for welcoming me into your holy and calm home, not often found in a house of worship, as I've experienced growing up in different communities. Anyway, as I said, I grew up in a very Orthodox community where I was a good girl. I was permitted to leave school on Fridays so that I could go home and prepare for the Sabbath. We were observant Jews, which meant that there was no cooking, no creating, laws going back to the building of the temple are enforced now. So you don't use a car, you don't use electricity, you do not write. You don't use anything that makes noise. And so all the preparations done on Friday for Saturday. And it was I still do the kosher dietary laws at home. And I never thought to question what I was learning. As you heard, my background is very strong in the Old Testament. And I was studying and I was learning and I had stories. And then when I came to Stockton to teach, they said, what else would you like to teach besides writing? And I said, women in the Bible. And so I started reading the actual text, which is where I got an advantage over most people, is that I look at the Hebrew words. And from that, I'm able to decipher what is written incorrectly. And that's what I mean by what did they want us to hear. So the first thing we learn about Eve is that she was made on the sixth day. Human was created on the sixth day. And one thing that I found that really I thought was beautiful that fit here is that it says that God said, in our image, we will create human. And in his image meant, some really neat things that I said, wow. It means that we are all equally valued, which is not something we often see. It means we are equally deserving of respect and dignity. It means that God is without form or gender, as we are initially. If we define ourselves as being made in the image of God, no one else can define us or our gender. And I didn't know that much about your synagogue, your house of worship before. And when I started reading, I said, wow, that's really appropriate, how perfect that is and how that matches with the way that I teach at Stockton as well. So, but once you read the story, it says that God created not man, but a human. And in Hebrew, it says he blessed them and he told them. As opposed to, you know, there's 6 days of creation with your animals, the stars, the moon, blah, blah, blah. And then you have Adam, and then most people think that Eve then later came from his rib. So we have two opposing stories. One is that they were both created simultaneously in chapter one, and then chapter two comes about where she is then created from his rib. And from this being created from his rib and his response, we became a thing. It actually says this, which I'll read to you in a moment, which I've not in English, but in Hebrew. Oh, excuse me. So initially, they were created. So how do you come to grips with one person or one thing being created that's a them? Male and female, he created them. Thoughts? There are a lot of different ways to look at it. One is that they were connected side by side. I like to think that they were created back to back, initially the thought, because when they were separated, as I'll show you later, as a relationship, you need to face each other. You need to walk side by side sometimes, but you also need to face each other and face the issues. Good times, I'm not so happy with you at this moment until we get back together again. So there are different views of how. But again, initially, she was created simultaneously. Then it says God rested. And in chapter 2, it goes on to say that there was no one on the earth to take care of it. I'm like, wait a minute. He just created them. Now you're telling me no one's there. And again, that's something else that we have chapter two. Now everything is being put on the ground. But when he creates human, not man, Adam is different, Adam, from the ground, is different than Ish, which is a male. So to me, he created that human being, something from the ground, from the dust of the earth. And it says that God breathed breath in through his nose. And one commentary that I read was, he didn't breathe air into his ears because you hear evil. Eyes see evil, mouth speak evil, but the nose takes the oxygen and filters it out and brings out the good stuff. So I thought that was pretty neat. And then God says, whoa. Not good for him to be alone. So what am I going to do? He brought the animals to the human, and the human named them. And it's still, wait, there's no one like him. If you look at most English, and I brought even a Hebrew one, text, it says, not a helper. Whoa, I'm supposed to help him? And that's one of the thoughts, that my goal in life is to always help my husband. Before, when I had just met my husband, I had been set up on a date, and we went somewhere, and I remember sitting there drinking coffee, and he said to me, he was a doctor, so I was to be impressed, that he heard I'm a good bulabusta. That's Yiddish for a good homemaker. I know how to cook, I know how to clean, I know my place. I went to the yeshiva, so I know all the rules. I know family purity rules. And so he's looking for a wife who, when he comes home from work, will have everybody fed, quiet, and his food will be ready for him on the table. I said, excuse me. I got up. I went to the payphone, because you know back then we didn't have cell phones. I put a quarter in, and I called the gentleman, who is now my husband of 36 years, and said, hey, Rob, what you doing? I'm coming down there. Walked back, picked up my stuff, and said, I am definitely not who you are looking for. And I went on. But people, and in my classes, we have people of all religions. Fewer Jews than Jews, if you can imagine. I'm sorry, the other way around. Fewer Jews than non-Jews. Very few Jews are in the classes. This past semester, I had 14 students graduate with a minor in Jewish studies. None of them were Jewish.
Wow.
Right. Even when I was teaching Hebrew, I had Arabs in Hebrew. I had all the people who wanted to be a pastor, people who took my Bible class and wanted to actually see what was going on. And we offer 10 classes a semester approximately. All my professors are not Jewish. I have a Muslim professor. I have Christian professors. I have Jewish. I have Orthodox. I have Reform. My goal is to teach people, to have people teach who will have a positive impact. Because when you learn about Eve, you want to learn about relationships, not that she is to serve him. The actual word is keneged negdo, which means a help meet, which means someone who goes against you. You don't want a partner who's always going to do what you want them to do. You want someone who's going to say, that shirt doesn't match, or I don't think that's going to work. Someone who will challenge you, someone who will push you. And yet the words that are given to us in all these different English translations is a helper. So that's one of the issues. So then we go on, and she is created. God is the one that says he needs someone. Doesn't say he needs a he or he needs a she. The human needs someone. It then goes on to say that he put the human to sleep and took something from him and then put him back together. Most people think it's a rib. There are a lot of different commentary. One is it's tsela, also means a side. And the only other time that word tsela is really used in the Old Testament is the side of the cabinet that was holding the Ten Commandments. So that's why we think of the word side. Now on another end, for anyone who's a physician here, some men have an extra rib. I had a big argument with someone over this. And they said, Marcia, you do realize that even the person who graduates last in their medical school is still a doctor? I said, yes, but some men actually have an extra rib, which I thought was pretty cool, that she could be taken from the rib. The other research is R-rated, and that, but it came from the archaeology, it's peer-reviewed journal, I don't agree with it, but that she was developed from his baculum. If you believe in evolution, and that animals were first, and then came the human being, that apes have a penis bone, but men do not. And I can make all kinds of jokes about it, but it was in a peer-reviewed journal, so I feel obligated to share that as well. What can I say? So here we have again, now God took that woman, and what does the human say? Whoa, man, literally, woman, whoa, man. And he takes the word ish for man, and makes it Isha. And the letter at the end is a hey, fifth letter. And that is the letter we use to write God's name when we don't want to write it out. So I thought how beautiful that Adam actually maybe thought of that, that he took male and added God's name to it to make it female. Again, respecting her as you would a god. There's a saying that if a man marries an evil woman, he becomes evil. And if an evil man marries a good woman, he will become a woman. A good woman. Oh, sorry about that. That didn't come out right. I was thinking of my next thing. Hey, that happens too, so it's okay. There's actually a book, and it's called Becoming Eve. And it's the story of an ultra-Orthodox gentleman who was a very well-known married rabbi in Brooklyn who did transition and become a female. And her name is now Abby Stein. And it's interesting for me to read her commentary because now she's looking at it as a woman and not from a man's viewpoint. Because all of the things that we're reading is patriarchal. But that's because that's where we come from. You can't be angry at the rabbis for thinking this stuff. It was what they learned. We all have cultural bias, the way we grow up. I use the word ghetto, didn't know that's not a word I should be using. I think of Holocaust ghetto. I grew up in a Jewish ghetto, but then there are other uses. We all have different biases based on how we grow up. So I teach people to say, that's interesting, may not be for me. Thanks for sharing. We've got to be respectful. I do call my Orthodox girlfriend and say, all right, now that I told you this, what do you think? And they're like, well, it's interesting, but I'm still not allowed to teach it. I'm like, okay. And I tell my students who teach Sunday school, you better check with the pastor. I mean, I'm showing you this is coming directly out of the Old Testament. What's really cool is no matter where you go in the world, no matter how far back you go, when you find a copy of the Old Testament in Hebrew, it is identical letter for letter. And that's why I'm comfortable teaching and showing the problems, because I'm going back and looking at actual texts in Hebrew. And no one has changed those, only the English. All right, so now we have a male, we have a female. Before that female was created, the human was given instructions. Do not eat from the tree in the center of the garden, because if you do eat from it, you're going to die. It's in masculine singular, not plural. Hebrew's great. If I say you, I can say you masculine, you feminine, you plural. If I do you plural for masculine and feminine, it's masculine singular. She's not instructed not to eat. Only he is. And when that snake, which we will discuss in a moment, asked her, is it true you're not supposed to eat from it? She said, we're not supposed to eat from it nor touch it. So people say, see, she lied. Or, ooh, she wanted to be like God. Again, putting her down. And we have a couple different issues here. Number one, where did that do not touch it come from? I don't see anywhere written where she got instructions, which to me meant it came from Adam. And like a parent, we give extra instructions, right? We add two things. Now, if it's a snake, where do you think the snake was that they could be seeing each other face to face? In the tree. So if she says, I'm not allowed to touch it, and he's touching it, and nothing's happening, she begins to think, something's going on here, just a possibility. And then, of course, people say, who gave her the idea not to eat? Who gave her the idea not to touch? Someone or something did. So the story goes on that the snake says, well, no, you're going to get knowledge. You're going to be like God. It's pretty. It tastes great. And she says in the text, she thought, knowledge? Can you start to see what we're not allowed to do as women is get knowledge? Because when, like me, you get this knowledge, you become a troublemaker, you know a little bit more than maybe you should know. And the men don't like that we have this knowledge. So let's go back 1 second to the snake. Does anyone know how the snake in this story is perceived? How is he described?
Evil.
Pardon me?
He's evil.
He's evil, that's right. He's conniving, he's evil. Look what he's doing. What did he do wrong? He said, you're not going to die. He told the truth. A whole great lesson on this one. He didn't lie. You would get knowledge. It tastes good. You'll be like God, you'll know right from wrong. But more than that, I discovered this a couple years ago, the word for naked is arum. The word that they use for conniving is the identical word. How can he be conniving and Adam and Eve naked? They're either both naked or they're both conniving. But they needed to set something up that somebody bad convinced her to do something. Something that she may have never gotten the right instructions. And again, when I teach this, I talk to students and I say, when you have children, don't ever say you're never going to drive the car again and you're never going to go out again, because you will. And they all start to laugh. I said, you've got to make your punishments measurable and immediate and understandable. And neither of which was going to work for Adam and Eve. So again, we're blaming her, especially knowledge. Women are not allowed to learn. A woman who learns is evil. I'd say trouble, but definitely not evil. And so we have been put down based on this Adam and Eve story. And then it says, and she gave some to her husband, and what did he do? He ate it. I learned that she smashed it into a juice and gave it to him. Rashi is a very famous commentator. Another one is that she hucked him, which is Yiddish for nag. And she said, eat it, eat it, eat it, eat it. And he couldn't take it anymore, so he ate it. There are numerous stories of how she got him to eat it. And then I'm reading, wait a minute. He was there. It says she gave some to her husband who was with her. And I went through the roof. He was there? Why didn't he stop her? Why didn't he say anything? And why is it her fault? And I keep looking for more and more things. And then you're going to get your punishment, right? They run away. They're scared, they're naked, they hide. What does a kid do when they're scared? A young child hides. It's very natural because we did something wrong. Immediately, God approaches the human, the male, and says, did you, masculine singular, eat from the tree? I see the finger. I don't know why. I told you not to eat it. That's what I hear him saying. The woman you gave me, that's the response. You gave it to me. The woman you gave me made me do it. And then God says to Eve, and that's not her name, that's a whole nother story. It's Chava. Where this Eve came from, I still haven't figured out. I thought it was evil, but that's just me. He said to her, what did you do? I hear a different voice. He could be, what did you do? And she said, the snake tricked me. And the snake, he automatically gave a punishment. Didn't even ask him any questions. He expected more from the snake. But again, what did the snake do wrong? He told her the truth. And why is that so bad? And why is knowledge so bad? And more than that, if he didn't want them to eat from the tree, why is it in the middle of the garden? Right? You have something, if you say don't eat the cookie, the person's gonna eat the cookie. It's just natural. I say that if I have a bag of Doritos at my house, and they're in the closet, and I open them, I'm not making my husband eat them, but I know that he will. I have tempted him. He has free will, but I'm the one. I opened it, okay. So maybe that's really what the intention was. By God, so stop blaming the women for this one. So then you have a couple more. One of the punishments, human is going to have to now create his own food. He's going to have to plant. His punishment really is for male and female. It's for human beings. What's her punishment? She's going to have pain during childbirth, and yet she's still going to desire him. Okay. Oh, this is online. I have to tame this one down. It's going to hurt. It's natural. Some women have pain for childbirth. Some do not. My daughter-in-law just plucked this little guy out, the first baby. They were in the emergency room, and boom, within an hour, this kid, you know. So not everybody. So to me, that's a premonition. And yet she's still going to want to be with him. She's still going to want to have relations, even though it hurts. She's going to forget about it. To me, that's not a punishment. That's a premonition. And then comes the other one. It says in English that he will rule over you. That is not what it says. The word is mashal, which means an example. He will help set examples for you and with you, not this ruling stuff. There is no he should be ruling over you. To me, that's not a punishment. Again, it's about relationships and talking and being together. And yet, there's a website called Bible Hub, and you can pull up 120 different Bibles. And that's what I have my students do. I have a book-free class, which means I don't use books. I have them find things on the internet. If it's a story, I put it in. They can't afford everything. One thing about Stockton is that most of our students work full-time in addition to going to school. It's not like at Rutgers where you have a lot of kids. I always say, look in the parking lot, and you'll see what kind of people go to Stockton. My father used to call my synagogue the Mercedes-Benz Synagogue, because that's when you saw in the congregation now called Shirat Hayam type of a thing. But what is this control about? And using Adam and Eve and the story, And in English translation, she's a wife. She goes from being a woman to a wife. And as soon as she's introduced to Adam, brought, that's a gift. Wow, God brings you a gift. And you say, whoa, man. You have a woman. And then he says, notice how big the print is. Mm-hmm. One second. Because I have so much with the Hebrew here. One second. Anyway, I can find it. You'll trust my interpretation. As soon as he's given her, he says, a man will no longer be with his mother and father, he will now be glued to his wife. Ooh, I see something and now she's mine. I'm gonna go from my mother and father and I'm gonna be glued, I'm gonna be stuck, you're mine. Again, that's this idea of control and how it changes from woman to wife. Later on, he gives her the name Chava, C-H-A-V-A-H. In Hebrew, the way you really get the sound is you, I think the word they use now is lugi, I use talker, you, that's how you get the ch sound, Chava. It's not Eve. Eve comes from a Latin word, Ava. Ava still is nothing to do with giver of life. So he was initially very overwhelmed with her. Wow, giver of life, and yet it's been turned. Some people say, what do you mean giver of life? God's the giver of life. I'm like, give me a break. When I read commentary and I look at the words, I'm just amazed at how things are constantly, this book I brought is from the conservative movement. First thing I do when I find a new Bible, open up to the beginning, and when chapter 2, they eat from the fruit, and she gave it to him, and I want to see if it says who was with her. Because that changes the whole dynamic of the story. This is the new conservative one, and it wasn't changed. I said to my brother, what's going on here? They're making changes. There is now gender-neutral language for Hebrew. It's very complicated, and you really have to practice it a lot. And there is a gender-neutral prayer book as well that has been developed in some communities, which I also thought was pretty cool. So, but I go back to we're made in his image. And the his, I think, is more habit than anything. So we're made in God's image, formless, sexless, that's such a word, limitless, potential, awe-inspiring. And that's how we have to treat each other, because we're all made in the image of God. And I teach my students most specifically, if you are a male or a female and your partner is swearing at you or not speaking to you in a respectful way, you need to think about that. I have never said F you to my husband. Doesn't mean I didn't think it, but we don't talk like that. And I want these kids to know that's not a safe relationship. And so I'm able to take all of these different stories, Sarah, don't even get me started, the way that she is looked at, and things we are not told about. It's all about relationships, but seeing the right side. And you get to decide, look at the English, but you can't, then you have to call me. What's it say, Marcia? And I go back. So I'll leave you with one little tidbit. The very first letter of the Old Testament is a bet. It says, Bereshit. That does not mean in the beginning. Bereshit bara Elohim et hashamayim ve'et ha'aretz. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. That is the incorrect translation. It says in a beginning or when God began to create the heaven and the earth. We change things because people, we, English, because people would say, well, in the beginning, created God. So the very first letter is a bet. If you can imagine, I'm almost drawing a house with a line underneath. Only one side is open, looking forward. The right side is closed. Don't worry about what happened before. It's time to move on and just go forward. Or as I read once, your rear view mirror is very small. Your front window when you drive is very large. Learn from the past, but look more towards the future. And there's a big future there for all of us. And thank you. Questions? This is my passion. This is just my poor husband. Any questions? Okay. Yes.
Is there a in English words translation of how the Hebrew Bible is written?
Not a good one. I have all of them.
There are some available.
There's tons of them. There's one called a Woman's Bible that was put out by women, and that has better commentary and better English. But I just go through all of them, and I just find things that are wrong, and I don't know why they haven't been changed.
It was my understanding when I read a few books on the history of the English language that when the King James Bible was written, the people that translated it from the Hebrew were told to make it poetically beautiful, even if they had to change something. So it may not have been always intentional.
The King James is one of the better.
Yeah.
So, but I just go from word to word.
Was it originally written in Aramaic?
Yes. But the letters are the same.
The meaning of the word is the same?
Yes. And we had the Old Testament, then you have commentary, which is called the Mishnah, and those are the laws and regulations, again, written by men, and then you have the commentary on that from the oral law. And it's all written by men. Again, of that time, I was very respectful of it. But now it's time to really look at what it really says versus what they wanted it to say. And not get in too much trouble about it.
Thinking about the role of Mary Magdalene, do you talk about that too?
I do not cover anything in the New Testament because I cannot go back to an original text and know what it really says. Because there's so many different versions, I don't know which one, and I just say, wow, that's great. When I first taught about Abraham and Sarah, and three angels came to visit, a student said to me, well, that could have been the Trinity. I'm telling you, I would have gone right through that wall. Then I said, brilliant, why not? To be open to their ideas. And they don't all agree with you. You never have to agree with me in my class. Absolutely not. I prefer you challenge me. What are your thoughts? What do you think? How do you feel? And then I always have an assignment. If you were Sarah, what would you have done? If you were Eve, what might you have done? And try to get them to do it. Thank you. Yes, I was waiting for that. I don't know why I do notes. I never use
them. Thank you very much, Marcia. Please rise now in body or spirit, both if you like, and join in singing our closing hymn number 1052, The Oneness of Everything.
So just a couple of words about this hymn. So you may have noticed that Gina, our regular music director, is off today. So you have our backup musicians. Thank you, Cynthia. And what that means is that Cynthia and I got to choose the hymns, and so we chose ones that we really like, but they're not necessarily easy to sing. So this one, the words are really beautiful, so if you're not familiar with it and you prefer to just listen, that's fine, but please feel free to try it out. And so hoping that this might help fit the theme for Marcia's talk, so thank you.
And the rights and needs of both individuals and community. May we act wisely and well. Let us read the words together for extinguishing the chalice. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry on our hearts until we are together again. Such other business as may come before the congregation. Members of the congregation may vote in one of three ways: by attending the meeting in person, by absentee ballot. An absentee ballot will be made available upon request and must be received by the board secretary before the start of the annual meeting at 11:15 a.m. June 12th in order to be counted, by proxy. A proxy letter signed by the absent member authorizes another member to vote on the absent member's behalf. Newcomers who want to learn more about our congregation have been invited to remain after the service for a gathering in the sanctuary. We will take a short break and will begin as soon as we can thereafter. If you are not involved in this, please leave the sanctuary promptly. Thank you. Join us next Sunday for a service presented by Paul Utz. Where do we come from? Who are we? And where are we going? These three questions from a popular UU hymn ask the questions that are the basis of almost all faith communities, and for that matter, much of scientific inquiry. But as our faith community enters a new phase, these are questions, as a community, we need to ask ourselves. Paul will talk about where we came from and explore the questions of who we are as a community and where we go from here. We warmly welcome all of you who are visiting us today. If you are new to our congregation, please follow the link in the electronic order of service to complete a connection card so that we may get to know you better. Parents are encouraged to stay for the final moments of worship and to retrieve their children from outside or downstairs after the bell has sounded. Now let us share a moment of silent reflection to consider today's messages and the meanings, the meaning they have in our lives.